Good morning and welcome. I invite you to turn to the first page of the bulletin and join together responsively in our call to worship. You who live in the shelter of the Most High will say to God,
"My refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust."
God will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence.
We will not fear the terror of the night or the arrow that flies by day.
A thousand may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you.
No evil shall befall us.
God will command the angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will bear us up, so we will not dash our foot against a stone.
We know what God will be delivered. God will answer when we call.
Our first hymn is a Lenten hymn. So it means it's unfamiliar, but I suspect you will recognize the tune, because as I told Kaylee, it's the communion hymn she's playing next month. Lord Jesus, who through 40 days...
From the book of Deuteronomy. When you have come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you. And you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God: "A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number. And there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power and with signs and wonders, and brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house. A reading from the Gospel of Luke. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only God." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, God will command the angels concerning you to protect you. And on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from Jesus until an opportune time. Here ends this lesson. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Tests. I don't know anybody who likes taking tests. Even good students don't generally like taking tests. And many of the tests in our lives we can study for and prepare for. But as most of us have discovered these last 2 years, there's at least one test we can't really do much to prepare for. And that's that joyous event of having them stick a skinny tube up your nose and swab it for your COVID test. But you still hope you pass. Staff have to get tested twice a week, and I admit, when I've been here 20 minutes and haven't gotten a call, there's a big sigh of relief. So we're all used to tests of one kind or another. For many of us, one of the big tests that we've had to deal with in our life is our driver's test. Now, for somebody like my husband, who grew up driving tractor on the family farm when he was quite young, because my husband's tall, so even at 8, he was taller than a lot of teenagers. So he drove tractor early. I wasn't even allowed to drive the riding lawnmower at home. So I had my first experience when Dad just started teaching me to drive. And I was nervous for my driver's test, especially because the night before we had 6 inches of fresh snow. The tester learned that he probably should have not just followed his routine of going to a particular side street to test on Y turns. Now they're called 3-point turns, but then they were Y turns. Because the driving tester had to get out and push the station wagon out of the snow I got stuck in. That was a test I was convinced I had failed. I was almost in tears. But I think he realized his own part in it, and he said to Dad, "She needs a little confidence, but she's fine." But I had prepared. Now, Jesus gets tested in our passage today, and we don't know if he expected this. In this version, Jesus is led by the Spirit. Elsewhere in the Gospels, he's driven by the Spirit. But he has just been baptized, and now he has to go spend 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness. Now, there are lots of people who do all kinds of wilderness training these days. But the reality is, this was to some degree the environment Jesus was used to. But he wasn't used to spending 40 days and 40 nights out there. And we all know the desert is generally bereft of food and water. And I don't think he was even given a chance to grab a bedroll. He just went out there. And so he is tested. As we hear it, not tested so much by God as by the devil, by Satan, by the evil one, whichever language you like to employ. And Jesus passes. He passes every test of temptation that is put before him. He didn't have to study for this test because his whole life was preparation for this test. The little boy who disappears from his parents, and when they find him in the synagogue, amazing, the rabbis, says, "Did you not know I would be in my father's house?" The young man who picks up the Torah scroll on the Sabbath and reads from the prophet and says, "Today this has been fulfilled," was ready. He was ready to do God's work. He understood who and what God was and is and was doing and is doing. And the way he refuted the devil, the means by which he passed every test, was not some kind of crib sheet written on the palm of his hand or the sole of his shoe, but was the word of God written on his heart. And so time and again, he cites scripture to refute the evil one. You and I may not have that same kind of grasp of scripture and its nuances, but we are here today, in a sense, studying for, preparing for our test. We are using this time of worship to strengthen us to sustain temptation. We are sharing at this sacred meal so that we can be nurtured and fed, not fully our hunger, obviously, but our need to connect with God. And it is that that sustains us. It is that faith that helps us sustain the tests of life. This week, for most of us, thinking about things like Ash Wednesday, when we see the horror of cities in Ukraine with buildings turned to ashes. As we see reports of somebody saying, "My mom called me and said she was able to get bread today." It is our reminder that we should not take lightly this meal, because we do not know when we might be the ones dealing with hunger on a physical level. But God always knows we are dealing with hunger on a spiritual level. And so today, we come to be fed. Fed by the Word, fed by the love of God, fed at the table of Christ, and fed by the fellowship of this community of believers. And those things are what help us pass any test there is with flying colors. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we pray for the people of Ukraine, for those who have died and those who mourn them, for those who are fearful that they may be strengthened, for families torn apart, for people going hungry. We pray as well, O God, for the many innocent citizens of Russia who had no idea what was going on. We pray for citizens of all lands around the world. We pray for countries that are welcoming refugees. We pray for countries like Afghanistan and Syria that have their own share of people who are now refugees. And we are mindful, O God, that we are truly one human family. We pray for the world in the midst of war and in the midst of COVID. We pray for our community here at Three Pillars. We pray with and for the family of Phil Hildebrandt, who passed this last week. We pray for those who are ill or undergoing therapies or treatments or rehabilitation. We pray for health, healing, wholeness. We pray for wellness of body, mind, and spirit. We offer our prayers, O God, confident that you hear and that you do respond with love. We have this faith because we have the teaching of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. We gather in his name. We are fed by this time and by his broken body. And we rejoice to join together and pray the prayer he taught long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I invite you now to turn to the bulletin and join together in our offertory prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, we are grateful for the many blessings we have received. As we remember Jesus' teaching that we cannot live by bread alone, we are mindful that we can share what we have. We pray that you will bless these gifts as you have blessed us. Amen. Our communion hymn is Let Us Break Bread Together. Communion, I alternate each month among a number of the mainline Protestant denominations. This month we are using the liturgy from the United Methodist Church, and one of the things I like is that they put the prayer of confession as part of the communion liturgy. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with you always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body. For we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. I invite you now to take and eat. I invite you to turn to the top of the last page and join in our prayer of thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.